bow our heads before the Lord today. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for allowing us to come into your house one more time. Father, we thank you for taking us down through this week, oh God. We thank you for our life, oh God, our health and our strength. Oh God, we thank you for everyone that is in the room on today. And Father, we thank you for those that are on their way. We pray for traveling mercies on today, oh God. And Father, we pray that you illuminate us, oh God, in your word on today, that you would open up our understanding in the mighty name of Jesus. Help us, oh God, to see and hear your word, oh God, that we may know what your will is for our lives. And Father, we pray that you will continue to bless our pastor, that you will continue to speak through him in the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, please continue to bless those that are sick, those that need deliverance, and those that need healing. Father, we know that you are the unseen guest, and we want to praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God.
Thank God.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Thank God for Sunday school today. I praise God for seeing everybody that is here today, and I thank God for his word. God has been good to us. Amen?
Amen.
In spite of all the things that we got to go through, God yet has been good to us. And I thank God for the lesson on today, which is found in Mark chapter 14, verses 26 through 31. And verses 66 through 72. Those that desire to read, we'd like to read the lesson together. I was looking for my other book. I don't know if this is it. But the title of our lesson is entitled Struggling Faith. Anybody ever had faith that you struggle with? Ever been through something and struggled to believe God? Well, this lesson is going to open up our understanding in struggling faith. So let's start in Mark chapter 14, in verse 26. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. What does it say in verse 27?
Jesus said unto them, all you shall be offended.
And a maid saw him again and began to say to them that stood by, this is one of them. What does it say in verse 70?
And he denied him again. A little after, they stood by and said again to Jesus, surely thou art one of them, thou art a believer.
1972. And a second time he caught the crew, and Peter called to mind the word that Jesus said unto him, "Before the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me thrice." And when he thought thereon, he wept. May God bless unto the readers and the hearers of his word. Struggling Faith is the title of this lesson. Earlier, this lesson starts in verse 26, but earlier in the chapter, we see where Jesus was being anointed by the woman with the alabaster box. And also earlier in this chapter, Judas was preparing to betray Jesus, and Jesus telling him he was going to be betrayed. A lot of times, as we read in the Word of God, we have to realize God's Word is what to us? It's truth. So it's not going to change. If you read it today, it's going to stay the same, and tomorrow is going to be the same. Yesterday, it was the same. So there's not going to be any change to it. So in the Word of God, several times, Jesus had already spoken to the disciples and gave them an understanding of what was to come. So we find in verse 26, he says, when they had sung a hymn, also remember this is Passover time, they went out into the Mount of Olives. And Jesus saith unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. What was he saying, somebody tell me, when he says offended? All of you shall be offended because of me this night. No, ma'am, not that. Not in this particular instance. But in this particular instance, he's talking about causing them to stumble. That's what the offense was going to be. Because when Jesus is on the scene and the disciples now who are following him have to answer to following Christ. Look at in the countries, the third world countries, that a lot of people now are coming to Christ. But it's not popular. Not only is it not popular, it's against their world religion. So they don't want someone who's been calling on a Buddha God to all of a sudden start talking about Jesus. Well, they don't want somebody that's been calling on Allah to all of a sudden start talking about Jesus. So when they decide that I'm going to follow Christ, it's an offense to others. And they find out, well, you betrayed us. You're going in a different direction. So in third world countries, they're being persecuted like some people in the Bible were back in Bible days. In some places, and I've read this, where you have people that were of different ethnicities, and their religion was either some type of statue or something that they worshipped, and they turned away from it, and their own families were instructed to take their lives. Because they hold these truths so tight. So their own mothers, their own fathers, their own brothers are sent after them to take their lives. That's happening today. That's not something that was years ago or back in Bible days like it was happening. That's today. So people are suffering for wanting to serve Christ. Well, here we find this happening with Peter. They were going to take Jesus and they were going to crucify him. But any followers they could get their hands on, they were going to also crucify them. So when Peter come along and they said, we believe you're one of them, Peter had a choice to make. So this is why the Word of God said, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. How many of you know Jesus doesn't lie? So if he said it, it's going to what? Come to pass. So he's telling them this is coming, and they're letting them know, no, it's not. Well, if we say it, You might be able to say that back to one of us. Well, no, that's not going to happen. I'm not expecting that. That's not accurate. But if Jesus says it, just accept it. Amen? And he said it, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written. See, this is what I love about God's word. It doesn't change. It's written. So if you believe God's word, then you accept it. I don't care if you don't see it, if you can't touch it, if you can't smell it, you can still believe it. Amen? He said, I will smite the shepherd and the sheep shall be scattered. When there is a man of God that's put before God's people, a lot of times the enemy, and we see it happening today, does everything he can to somehow destroy that shepherd. What happens to the congregation when it happens? You see large ministries where they shamed the pastor somehow. Haven't we? He's been cut down somehow, and what happened to the congregation? They scattered. They've been split. Some go home and say, I'm never going back to church again. I don't want anything to do with it. Some leave and go to ministries where they are not getting what God would have for them. So it behooves us to keep the pastor in prayer. Amen? We're not worshiping him. We're worshiping God. And if he's following God, then you can follow him. Amen? So we thank God for the pastors and the shepherds that God has before his people today. Because they're mouthpieces for God. But how many of you know you can be a mouthpiece as well? Amen. You can be a mouthpiece and you can be used of God. You don't have to have a title or position. God called every last one of us. Amen. He wants to use everybody. All he wants you to do is make yourself available. Next verse, but after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. I love this. In verse 27, he said, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written, I will smite the shepherd and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that, isn't he awesome? See, for all of us, there is an after that. I know you may be going through something that's hard on you right now, but there is an after that. And all we got to do is believe it. But Jesus said to them, but after that, I am risen. I will go before you into Galilee. Now he's letting them know, not only are they going to kill me, but guess what? I'm going to get up. So we don't have to worry or be ashamed. How many of you know, and I've said this before, everybody's sins in the world has been paid for.
Amen.
Hasn't it? Whether you accept it, whether you believe it, your debt's already been paid. And some people will not accept that payment. But it's yet been done. And God has already let us know in his word that all we have to do is do what? Believe it and receive it. And some people still won't do that. That's all he said for us to do. Believe it and receive it. He didn't say go to work every day and never miss and you might get it. He didn't say get up every morning and do this, that, and the other until you go to bed at night and you might get it. Amen. He didn't say you had to do every good deed possible and you might get it. He told us what? Believe it and receive it. And some people today still will not believe the gift that's been given to us. They won't receive the gift that's been given to us. But that's all he wants us to do. But he said, after that I'm risen, I will go before you into Galilee. But Peter said unto him, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. Now Jesus has already spoken. Amen? He's already told them, you're going to be offended because of me this night. Now they've seen his exploits. They've seen what Christ has done. They've seen who he was. They've watched him walk in truth. But yet when he speaks, somebody comes back and says, not me. I'm not doing that. Sometimes the truth can hurt. Amen? Sometimes when you find out what's real, it's hard to accept that. But Jesus has already said, you all, he didn't say just you. He said all of you will be offended because of me. Now, is that happening today? Is it happening today? Because some people don't want to accept the accusation or the mistreatment that goes along with serving Christ. So when somebody says, you don't sound like, when I was growing up, I had friends, and I was raised in church all my life, and even though I was not serving God as a teenager at that time, they kept us on the altar every Friday. I think every Friday, Monday, Tuesday, we was on the altar. Young kids, we were on the altar. Praising and crying out to God. And I remember being with some friends of mine, and we were all hanging out together in school, and everybody was saying what they say, and you know, they could just swear, and words would just roll off their tongue. I thought, I could do that. So we all talking, and I started trying to do what they were doing. And I'm just saying every bad word they were saying, I'm just trying to kick in with it. I remember one of my friends looked at me, she turned, she said, you don't sound right saying that. I thought to myself, I've been practicing swearing for a long time. What you mean I don't sound right? I didn't say this to her, but I'm thinking to myself, I've been practicing this. But she told me, she said, you don't even sound right saying that. So I had to learn how to just be who God made me to be. You don't fit in every mold. If you serve God, you're not going to fit anyway. You're going to stand out. And even if you try to fit in, somebody going to look at you and say, you don't sound right saying that. I work with a gentleman, he's an engineer, and I work with him, and he said to me yesterday, he said, you have to be the only person I know that works here that doesn't swear. I said, I'm sure there's somebody else in here that doesn't swear. You just don't know him. He says, I don't know him. He said, but I don't know anybody who doesn't do that. That's the culture we live in. But as Christ, as his children, you're going to be different. You're not going to fit in. And everything that the world does is not going to fit you. Why? Because you're in a different kingdom. What the world does, you don't do. What the world believes, you don't believe. And when somebody comes to you and tells you, this is the way it's supposed to go, you can easily say, but no, I don't do that. Because my Heavenly Father says, and whatever your situation is, you got a word for that. Amen? If it's sickness, you got a word for that. I had another gentleman come to me, and I'm asking the saints to pray with me for him. But he came to me yesterday, and I happened to be in the middle of doing something. I see him coming towards me, but there's a pathway behind me. And a lot of times people look like they're coming directly towards me, but they go behind me. So I wasn't sure where he was going, but I could see him. And he finally, I turned around and looked to see if maybe he went past me or where, and he was standing right next to me. And I looked and I said, oh, I'm sorry, I said hi. And he said, hi, Debbie. And I was in the middle of doing something, and finally I got finished, and I said, what's going on? And he said, I just wanted you to know I was diagnosed with cancer. And I just looked at him. And he said, that's what they told me. He said, I have to take chemo. I have to go through all of these different things. Now, how many of you know there are no accidents? God orchestrates your life. So God put him in a position to come to tell me that. And we're going to pray for him. And I told him, I said, before he left me, he said, they say it's no cure for this, but it can be in remission. I said, but God. I said, we're going to trust him for it. And he just said, okay. And he left. And I didn't see him anymore that night. But I'm going to find him. And I'm going to pull him aside. And I'm going to pray for him. And I'm going to believe God. See, there's nothing like a movement of God in a place where God is not reverenced. Because when God shows up, things begin to change. And you can have an atmosphere full of the devil. But all you need is one drop of the blood. How many of you know that? Just one drop of the blood. You ever had a color all red sitting there? You take something that's white and just drop it in there, and it just starts to mix, doesn't it? Starts to change the way it looks. That's the way Christ can do in an atmosphere like that. And if we allow him to come up in there, there can be a revival all over GM. Ain't that awesome? I want to see some folks praise the Lord before I leave there. I want to see some change before I leave there. I want to see healings before I leave there. And deliverance. And believe me, God is going to do it. And I thank him for it. He's already done some. But more is to come. I keep trying to run out the door, but the Lord won't let me. But that time is coming. And when they do, they won't even have to say goodbye. I'll be like, mail me my stuff. It's up out. But I'm there for a reason. We got to do what God put us there to do. So a lot of times we want to orchestrate our own life, but he said the steps of a good man are what? Ordered by the Lord. So if you want to follow him, even though the places that you're at are not comfortable, just continue to follow God and he'll do something where you are. I told my daughter, I was talking to her, and she told me, she says, Mommy, she said, all these different people she worked with, certain one just rubs her so bad. I said, Brittany, that's okay. I said, baby child, I said, that person for you is nothing but sandpaper. And either they're going to rub you smooth or you're going to rub them smooth. I said, but just keep on working it out. And it'll be okay. Amen. She wasn't happy about that because a lot of times my kids want me to give them an easy way out. When they tell me stuff, they want me to say, well, go ahead and leave, sweetheart. Go ahead and jump ship. Go ahead and quit. I don't say that a lot of times. And Brittany's the one that will tell you. Now, my oldest son and my youngest, they just get quiet and they have to go. All right, I gotta go. Brittany, she just, but Mommy, I didn't want you to tell me that. I don't call me. You're not always going to get what you want to hear from Mommy. Amen. Because I got to tell you the truth. But you may want to run, but sometimes you got to realize God has placed you somewhere and he's got something for you to do. And either you're going to help somebody or somebody is going to help you. Amen? So I thank God for his word and for knowing that his word to us is truth. And if God said it, that's enough for me. Amen? Next verse says, Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this day, even in this night, before the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. Now let me say it again. If Jesus said it, that's enough for me. Amen? Amen. So even though I don't want to accept it, it's yet true. Peter didn't want to accept it. So Peter said, but he spake the more vehemently, if I should die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise also said they all. They all said, not me. I'm not going to do that. But Jesus has already told you, yes, you will. But there's a reason for it. Number one, self-preservation stepped in. Amen? Self-preservation stepped in. It says, I got to do something to save my own self. Save my own life. But we have to become less independent and more what? Dependent on Christ. When we depend completely on Him, all of our needs are met. But when we try to fix it ourselves, we keep His hands out. We have to allow Him to come in and work everything out for us. Is that easy to do? Anybody? Is that easy to do? No. We're used to doing things for ourselves, aren't we? We're used to thinking, well, I'm the one going to work. I'm the one paying my bills. I'm the one taking care of this. I'm the one. But who gave it to you? Yeah. Who gave you the strength every day to get up? Who gave you the mind to know how to do it? Every bit of it. I was talking to somebody earlier this week at work, and they were talking about, you know, they have a degree for this, a degree for that, and, you know, it's going to take them there, and it's going to take them there. And I thought to myself, all we need is the favor of God. And it can take you wherever God wants to take you. And put you before that person that got that piece of paper. How many of you know that? Oh, yeah. If you have the favor of God, He can take you to high places. Also, He said what? Your gifts will do what? Anybody? Make room for you. Your gifts will make room for you. What does that mean? So we can quote the word, but we got to know what it means. What does that mean? When it says your gifts will make room for you.
Your blessings.
Your blessings? Okay, this is Tasha. Anybody else? Amen. Beautiful. Anybody else?
They'll also go before you and make good. What they'll do is they'll always keep doing that. The gifts work in the spirit. So they're going to do whatever they need to do. Make sure you have a room to go to the top.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Also, let me say this. When the Bible says your gifts will make room for you, you don't have to take it. Okay? Whatever it is that you're looking for, you don't have to take it. Think about Moses and Joshua. Moses and Joshua, when Moses told Joshua, come up here with me. There was nobody up there but him and Joshua. Moses was what? The leader. With just them two up there, Joshua could have done anything. And we on the cliff. Oops, he fell. He could have done anything to take his position. But he didn't do that. Why? Because his gift was going to make room for him. And whatever God had for him, he didn't have to trick somebody to get it. He didn't have to snatch it from somebody. All he had to do was wait for God to make room. So when the word tells us your gift will make room for you, you don't have to take anything. Just wait and let God give it to you. Yes, sir.
That is his work with David and Saul also.
Amen. David could have taken Saul's life. But David was also a man of God and a man of integrity. And he also knew that regardless of whether Saul was right or wrong, he was what? God's anointed. And he knew you don't touch God's anointed. So David had that much respect first for God. Not just for Saul, but for God. Because it has to be hard to serve somebody that wants you dead. How easy it would have been more than once, like Elder Hoover said, for David to take his life. But he chose not to because of his reverence for his Savior. Next verse, 66, as Peter was beneath in the palace, there cometh one of the maids of the high priest, And when she saw Peter warming himself, she looked upon him and said, "And thou also was with Jesus of Nazareth." Here's the offense. What did he say? "All of you will be offended because of me." Did he say that previously in the scripture? Let's go back. Verse 27, chapter 14 of Mark. Jesus said unto them, "All ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered." Come down to verse 67. "When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked upon him and said, And thou also was with Jesus of Nazareth." Now, Peter has to make a choice. Do I try to save my own mind? Do I run? What do I do? Self-preservation stepped in. But wasn't he told this was going to happen? He was told that. Next verse says, "But he denied, saying, I know not, neither understand I what thou sayest. And he went out to the porch, and the cock crew." Number one. Remember, if God said it, it's enough for me. Amen. Next verse. "And he denied it again." And a maid saw him again and began to say to them that stood by, "This is one of them." He denied it again. And a little after, they that stood by said again to Peter, "Surely thou art one of them, for thou art a Galilean, and thy speech agreeth thereto." Meaning, you sound like a... I know he says he's not like one of them, but he sounds like them. Remember I said when you belong to Christ, you sound a little different. You stand out. You don't blend in, and I don't care if you try to hide. Somebody will see you. Duck if you want to. But something about you is going to come through. Don't you want that for yourself if you're a child of God? You don't want to blend in with everybody anyway, don't you? You want to stand out. He says what? He says you are peculiar people. Something about you should be different if you serve in Christ. So they looked at Peter. It's like, I know I saw you with him. But then they added to it. No, you sound like him. Yes, I mean. Regardless of whether persecution comes, regardless of whether a saint falls to sleep, we have yet the victory. There is no loss here. Amen? There is no loss here as a child of God. If you serve him, whether in life or in death, you will yet have the victory. Because you're going to wake up on the other side. Amen? Yes, ma'am. Serving him is about. You ought to want to come to God's house, and every time you come, be changed a little bit more, conformed into his image. That's what we come for. Also, to uplift him together as a body of Christ. To encourage one another. To love on one another. How many of you know we all want big family? We all belong to one another. Because he said he did what? He took one blood and made all nations. So we all somehow connected with that one blood. He didn't say, well, when I started the world, I made this section and that section and this section and y'all all separate. No, he said, I took one blood and made all nations. So sorry to some of y'all, I'm your sister. We related. And that's all right in Christ. We related. A lot of times you get family members today, they want to deny each other. That ain't no family. Well, I'm sorry. Yes, they are. And I thank God for it. I thank God for all of you, my sisters and brothers in Christ. We need one another. Next verse says, but he began to curse and to swear, saying, I know not this man of whom ye speak. Jesus already told him, before the cock crew, he said, you're going to do what? Deny me what? How many times?
Three times.
Well, he's on number two. The second time the cock crew, and Peter called to mind the word that Jesus said unto him, before the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me three times. And when he thought thereon, he wept. Because finally, he realized what he said he did. And see, that's what the wonderful thing about God's word is. We know his word to be truth. So when we read it, whether we see the situation happening, whether we see ourselves delivered, whether we see ourselves healed, whatever it is that you need, if you receive God's word as truth, you can have it. Amen? Mark 11, 23. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, say that's me. Everybody say that's me. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, what? Be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart that those things which he said shall come to pass, he shall what? Have whatsoever he saith. That's the word. So we got to believe God's word and take it for our truth.
Amen.
And learn to walk in it. Because as we can see, even though Peter and the other disciples more than likely did not believe or even want to receive what Christ had told them, it yet, what, came to pass. So it doesn't matter, like I said, what's in front of you. I work with a gentleman and I've been trying to encourage him, but he told me, he said, I see myself doing this thing and I'm trying to go for Miss Debbie. I said, you halfway there? He said, I see myself in this position that I desire to have. I said, and you pray and you ask God for it. I remember listening to a song Karen Clark Sheard had, and she said her husband would always say, you got to see it before you see it, or you never will see it. The things that you desire from God, see yourself in it. See yourself there. See yourself doing it. See yourself working there. Whatever it is that you want from the Lord, see yourself there. And believe God for it. And guess what? It will come to pass. God's word is truth. And if He said it, all we have to do is believe it. And I will never sit here and tell you that's an easy thing to do. Because we can walk through, as the Bible tells us, yea, though I walk through what? The valley of the shadow of death. That's a dark place. So you may not walk through that with a smile on your face, but you yet believe I'm coming out. Because a lot of times we don't realize the only way out is through. You ain't going to get around it sometimes. You're not going to go over it. And you for sure ain't going under it. So the only way you're going to get through something or come out of something is to go through it. And He said He will do what? Never leave you nor forsake you. So as you're going through, He's there with you. Because His word also tells us He's a very present help in a time of trouble. And those scriptures I hold on to. Because this day and time, the enemy is coming at the saints left and right.
Amen.
He's not coming at us with no taps on the shoulder. He's coming out there with that foot out trying to trip you. And when He does trip you, He wants to keep His foot on your neck so you don't get up. What do you think is going to help you get up?
The word of God.
The word of God. Amen. That's going to help you up. Because the word of God is what? Quick and powerful, which means it's alive. So if you get to speak of this, there's no sense in calling on your sister or your brother's name. You better call them Jesus. And have the word of God down in your heart. This lesson is talking about struggling faith. Now, if you've heard nothing else, realize in order to get through struggling faith, I got to have God's word. Because God's word is my power, it is my anchor. And when the wind starts to blow in my situation, I don't have to topple over. I might sway a little bit, but I ain't got to fall overboard. Because I got something anchoring me down. And I don't care what I'm looking at. I yet have to believe God's word. How many of you have been in a situation where you've had to do that? Dark situations. Doesn't really matter. You yet trust God's word. Amen?
Amen.
Heavy? Yes. Sometimes hard? Yes. But I keep seeing what God showed me. And that is the three Hebrew boys, when they threw them into the fire. A lot of times we look at it like Jesus showed up after they got in there, but He showed me in a dream. He went in with them. He showed me that in a dream. He went in with them. They thought they threw three in, but He went in too. He doesn't show up when you get in your mess. A lot of times we said, Jesus, show up. He's already there.
Amen.
He said, I'm a present help in a time of trouble.
Yeah.
So when you have struggling faith, that word of God is what's going to help you. He's not just going to pop up. He's already there.
Amen.
So all you got to do is know He's there. Believe He's there. And trust Him to work it out. The struggle is only in your situation. It's not in believing God. Because you have to know His word. And if you know that His word says He's present, if you know that His word says He's not going to leave you, then there's nothing for you to do but trust him.
Amen.
You might not be taking leaps and giant steps. You might be crawling, but that's okay. Trust him. You might be taking baby steps a little bit at a time. Don't matter. Trust him. You might be flat on your back. It don't matter. Trust him. Amen?
Amen.
And I'm leaving you with this, and I'm going to turn this part of the service over to Pastor Dow. And I think I said this before, Elder Mixon. There was a football player years ago, professional football player, and he was a saved man of God. And another young player had just received Christ, and he had started to play. And he came into the team, and he was looking for a mentor, somebody that he could kind of grab onto, because like the lady said, the guy said at my job, I don't know very many people here, or any, that don't swear. So he's looking for somebody that's living a godly life. And he fixed his eye on this gentleman. And when you are a rookie, they kind of take you through some things. This gentleman was kind to him. This gentleman was supportive towards him. And he ended up becoming friends with him and found out he was a man of God. After they became friends, they were in a big game. And this professional football player got hurt. And everybody was talking about his injury being a career-ending injury. And the other gentleman, while he was out on the field, he asked him to go back there and check on him. He ran back there to check on him, and he fully expected him to be in a downtrodden, you know, upset because he heard about his injury. He's sitting on a gurney, and he walks into the locker room. And while he's there, he hears all this laughing and talking, and he goes around the corner thinking, this is probably not him. And here he's sitting on the gurney, he's just laughing and talking, and he looked up and he said, oh, maybe it wasn't that bad. He said, oh, they said you had, you know, this bad injury. And he says, well, I do. He looked up and he said, but why are you smiling and laughing? Because they don't come back from that injury. He said, your career is more than likely over. He said, but you don't understand. He said, I'm excited about what God has for me next. See, God is in control of my life. And if he closes this door, he's got another one he's going to open. So in spite of what it looks like to the world, that I should be in such a bad place because of this loss, there's no loss for us. It's just faith to faith. Amen?
Amen.
So God has a place that he's going to take you to. And if you just believe him, I don't care what door closes. And I don't care what the situation looks like. You can believe and trust God for the next step. So I thank God for this time and the lesson. I hope somebody got something out of the lesson today. I thank God for his word. His word is life to us. Amen?
Amen?
And we need to hold on to that life every single day. So at this time, in the hands of Elder Mixon.
So caught up in self, he forgot who he were. And forgot who Jesus was. Therefore, he tried to fix his situation himself. Sometimes, you know, we get in positions like that, and we try to do that, as the teacher was saying. You know, we try to fix it and make a mess out of it. Praise God. But nevertheless, praise God, we have to take God as his word. If he said it, he's able to see it done. Amen? We don't have to wonder about it. If he said it, We just have to have faith to know that he'll see it come to pass. Amen. I'm just so happy now. My heart is tickled. Amen. To be here with you on this morning. Praise God. It's a blessing within itself. And y'all look so beautiful out there on today. Thank God for you. Amen. If nothing else, amen. If nothing else, this brings our Sunday school to a close. Amen. Sister Davis, Brother Amos, praise God.